Does this mean stage music? And okay, so go ahead, go live. Wow. Well, there we go. And I still don't see my downstream key up there. But you know what? It doesn't matter because who cares what I want, right? This is Brad. This is the Main Stage Music weekly live stream. But guess what? I'm all by myself this week. Because Jamie is celebrating his anniversary. And I'll tell you what, that is really an awesome thing. And so we wish to send Jamie and his wife a wonderful happy anniversary from everybody here. So anyways, you know, we were discussing this week, what would you like to talk about? And actually, one thing we were embarrassed to admit that we've never discussed on here, in you know, it's a pretty broad subject, and that is recording yourself, okay? Now, I mean, it can be a very broad subject, okay? First of all, you have to think, why would you want to record yourself? You might say something like, man, I don't like the sound of my own voice. Or, I don't know, as kids, did you ever have a tape recorder and listen to yourself? And like, man, I sound so weird when I'm recording. Let me tell you something. There will come a time when you will listen to those ridiculous tapes that you might have done when you were a kid and yearn for those days to come back. Because honestly, recording is how we chronicle the human experience, okay? You know, it's not an uncommon thing for people to bring in tapes of their grandfather, maybe playing some guitar or maybe just reading, any number of different things. I think the very first recording that's ever was made was Thomas Edison reading Mary Had a Little Lamb. Who'd have thunk, right? It was back on an old wax reel recording. So recording, nonetheless, is a very important thing because it chronicles who we are, our culture, our history, your art, our craft. So again, recording is a big deal. But we also know that there's a wide span of different needs when it comes to recording. So you might have someone who says, oh, I'm going to record our band's album. Awesome. Or it might be something like our business needs to record this conference call. Or maybe you have a organization or a church perhaps that wants to record your message so that people who weren't able to attend can listen to it at a later date. Maybe you're one of these guys that like follows jam bands around throughout the summer and want to record all the performances to cobble together to make bootlegs. Long story short, there's a lot of reasons why people record stuff. And, you know, I kind of want to, you know, touch on a few things, but I want to assure you this. It is not as difficult as some people want you to think it is. Honestly, the recording industry is shaking in their boots and have been for a long time now because of the quality of the recording that you guys can make using minimal training and minimal equipment in your own homes or wherever. So, you know, that being said, you know, a lot of people get freaked out because the first thing that they picture is something like this right here when they're thinking of a recording studio. Yeah, this is actually one of the many recording studios at Capitol Records. You look at these immense mixing boards. You look at computer screens and, oh my goodness, a lot of buttons and rooms and, where do I even begin? And let me tell you something, it can be very complex. I mean, there's no doubt about it. But the fundamentals of all recording are fairly straightforward and simple, okay? You know, by the way, I see we got some viewers on here. We encourage your comments. We encourage your questions. And please, if you have a interesting anecdote that you'd like to share that you feel that other people watching might pull some information or knowledge from, hey, let me know and we'll read your comment on the air and so on. And I'll do my best to try to answer all your questions. I can't pretend to know everything. Well, I can pretend to know everything, but I can't say that I know everything. So moving right along, it may surprise you to know that this recording studio right here is one of just millions across Earth, okay, that is of this complexity level. But do you know where really, you know, more records are sold and so on? When recording studios look like this. Now, for people who are astute, you might go, wait a minute, I recognize one of those guys in that picture. Do you? Do you recognize one of those guys? Because let me tell you something. This photo was taken here in Tennessee, where, you know, Tennessee is no doubt the most important music place on earth. This was taken in the 1950s, early 50s, in Memphis at Sun Studios. Now, back in those days, you effectively had magnetic tape and a really good quality microphone, a single microphone, and a good quality preamp. Because if you're going to map out kind of, if you're like an analytical mind like I am, you kind of need to see things how they are. The way recording is very similar to the way a sound system works. Okay, and this is the skeleton kind of version. You have your input device. That can be a guitar, it can be a microphone, whatever. Then you have a preamp. Ah! Did you hear that? Then you have a preamp that your microphone or those input devices go into. That preamp boosts the level and allows you to tweak the sound a little bit. And then from that preamp, it would go to some sort of recording function, so tape or so on. Now, in a sound system, it's the same process, but the last step would be a power amp and speakers. So really, it's very similar to doing live sound. It's just that you're doing it in a controlled setting, okay? Like a studio. The studio, by the way, you know what you need to be to have a studio? Just whatever space you're occupying. No matter what anyone says, a studio is just wherever you are. So, now granted, there are some very high-tech studios where they spend a lot of time, money, and forethought in, you know, adapting their space to be just, you know, perfect for their style. Maybe to be soundproof or to reflect the sound in a certain way that just is audibly, you know, pleasing. But honestly, a studio is wherever you happen to be doing what you're doing, recording yourself. So it's just a space. Now, Sun Records, back in the day, if you can actually still go and tour, and I think I have not been there. I know I haven't been there, but that's going to be my goal for the next 12 months. I promise I will report back to you. I'm going to go to Sun Studios because I'm too old not to have been there anyways. So, but from what I understand, you can actually go to Sun Studios and still record using their setup. But their setup is this: they had one room, they had one mic, a preamp, and it went to tape. Now, you might think, well, wait a minute. How did they get all those great songs out of there? Let me tell you something. It's called talent. So back in those days, you had a song, and what the producer, Mr. Phillips, there would do is he would say, okay, well, we want this guy to sound the loudest, so you get closest to the mic. And that drum set, you're the loudest thing, so go back to the back of the room. So they had effectively mixed by just moving the instruments in different areas of the room. Kind of like they do in a stage performance of like a play or something like that. But I'll tell you what, if you've heard these iconic recordings, and 50 million Elvis fans can't be wrong, then you know that they did a great job early on. Now, the thing is about recording is it's come a long way since then. So Les Paul, who you guys might think is actually a guitar, but it's actually a human being named Les Paul from Wisconsin. And Les Paul invented in the mid-1950s what was called multi-tracking. It effectively meant that you could record on a piece, a tape, but then record again while that tape was running, creating multiple tracks. And I'll tell you what, it changed the world. It actually scored him a pretty neat honor. Les Paul is both in the Inventors Hall of Fame for his multi-tracking and so on, but also the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for all the contributions he made to music. But with Les Paul and his invention of multi-tracking, artists now were allowed to expand their minds to think, man, wouldn't it be great if there was two of me? Wait a minute, we can multi-track, we can do it. But I'll tell you, some people might nowadays, with all the equipment that's out there, might think, well, that's, you know, I just can't get my sound and I've only got 16 tracks. And let me just give you a piece of encouragement or criticism, whichever, however you want to take it. Did you know that Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, which some people regard as one of the greatest albums ever written and ever engineered, was done on a four-track? So when I was growing up, this is what a four-track looked like. It was basically a tape machine, like we talked about earlier. You had a preamp, which you can see there on the left side, actually four preamps. And then you had your tape recorder, which by that time, tapes had gotten a lot smaller than the big old thick machines that they had back in those days. Just regular audio cassette. Now, regular audio cassette had a left and right stereo channel on one side and a left and right stereo channel on the other side. So what you would do is you'd put that cassette in there, and when you'd record one track, it would record by just recording the left side of track A, and then track two would be the right side of track A, of side A of the tape, excuse me. And then the third track was the left, and the fourth track was the right of side B, but recorded in reverse. So if you actually took a four-track tape out of this machine and tried to put in a tape deck, you would either hear a recording going backwards or you'd only hear two tracks, depending on what kind of tape deck that you had. So it's pretty interesting to note that these recorders were pretty complex pieces of gear. First of all, we have some comments coming in, and I really appreciate you guys. Ron, Jamie, one of the most underrated, underappreciated gear reviewers of all time. Ron, I completely agree with you. He also added that here that Lynyrd Skynyrd recorded live, but I don't really know if that's true. You know, I wasn't there, so, but I highly doubt that they record. I mean, everybody records live at some point, which we'll touch on that. But I highly doubt that their studio albums were done live. And I'll explain that here in a second. And then we also had someone mention, is that Sun Records? You were right. Good eye. So moving right along with these tape four tracks that came out in the 1980s and 90s, which is, that's where I came from. Anyways, you would have to record on this tape, but then you'd need an additional tape deck or other to what's called mix down. So what you would do is you would find the levels of each track that you'd recorded and EQ. You can see the EQ knobs and so on there. Then you would press play. And then while what you'd be doing is playing that tape into another tape deck that was recording the finished product as your ears wanted it to hear. That was called a mix.
I apologize for interrupting, but we actually have a comment from YouTube. It is from a Jameson Fisher who says,
hey, Jameson.
Hey, Brad, do you guys carry any PAF style pickups?
Well, you know, I tell you, we do sell PAF style pickups. It's a little off topic, but, you know, you might want to check some of our older videos. We had one where it was live with Seymour Duncan, and Seymour Duncan is actually the first guy to make a PAF clone. And for people who didn't watch that episode, what PAF stands for is patent applied for. It's referring to the original humbucker that was invented by Seth Lover in 1956, 1957. And Seymour Duncan makes some of the best, world's best PAF clones. If you're looking for one that actually has an aged look to it and is custom made just one at a time, the Antiquity humbuckers are fabulous. We stock all of them. you definitely need to come either check out mainstagemusic.com to see our inventory, which is always vast, or if you're local here to East Tennessee, drop on by the store. We'd be happy to go over them one by one. But kind of moving back to the recording aspect of things, and thanks for the comments, by the way. Keep them coming. So with this, it was kind of complex. You first put in a tape, but then you had to have this recorder, and then you had to have additional tape recorder just to get a tape to give to your friends and show how cool you were, right? Well, I'll tell you what. This was great, and these are actually very popular again because all of these 20 and 30-year-olds who think that they're retro by using technology from the 80s and 90s, making poor people like me feel really old. They're really digging the lo-fi nature of using half-inch tape to record four or more tracks on. But it's still a pretty popular format, although they don't make them. The things that plagued these four tracks were, first of all, the complexity of them. But additionally, the sound quality was just meh at best. And you have to think, you had a lot of moving parts. So you had a lot of knobs that could... Actually, this picture I pulled off of Google, I can see a knob that was broke off. That was very common to happen on these. They were usually of kind of marginal quality. Additionally, you had all the record heads and motors inside. These things were not built to some sort of mill spec. So they wore out fairly quickly. And so, these things were not designed to last a long, long time. Now, where we are in as far as the modern day is the modern day multi-track, you may hear this term called DAW, D-A-W, like DAW, or yeah, that's pretty good. I like that, DAW. Anyways, what a DAW means, if you ever hear someone refer to it, it's actually them spelling or phonetically pronouncing a, what's wrong with my brain? But three letters, D, A, and W. And that stands for Digital Audio Workstation. And so if you want to see what a DAW looks like on screen, basically it's a piece of software. Now with software, there's no moving parts, obviously, so you don't have to worry about broken knobs, right, for your EQ and channel. But each one of these colored lines here is a visual representation of a track. So this particular guy right here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So he's got like 9, 10 tracks going. That's way more than the four that we had on the old tape deck. The other thing is that this is digital recording. So the old recording, they used magnetic signal on a piece of tape, okay? So it was an analog process. There's problems with analog. I mean, you start having signal degradation and so on. But with digital, it's just data, okay? Ones and zeros. And the more that our computing power can handle, the purer the sound of that digital data. And so nowadays, with computers being crazy good, you can make sound, like this broadcast that you're hearing is all done digitally. So the crystal clear quality happening real time, you're watching it on your phone. This is incredible. So with this DAW, a lot of computers come loaded with, you know, some sort of rudimentary free digital audio workstation. So you might be thinking, you know, I've got a laptop here. You might be going, well, wait a minute, I've got a laptop at home. Where do I plug the mic in on this thing? Well, you don't. Okay, so just like when you buy a computer at home, you have to buy stuff for it. Like most laptops aren't going to come with a mouse. Nowadays, they don't even come with a disk drive, you know, for like CDs to import stuff. They don't come with a lot of like little USB dongles to hook it to your, you know, larger monitor or any number of things. So another thing that they don't come with is a way to get audio into your computer. Well, enter modern day tech. This is simply called an audio interface, all right? So what an audio interface does is no different than like what any other little dongle does. So if you, let's say, need to get your smart card into your computer, you buy a dongle for it, right? Well, effectively, a USB audio interface is the same thing. It's just designed for your microphone or your guitar or whatever. This one here is made by Mackie. Mackie is a phenomenal name brand, but there are so too many to list. I remember back in the 1990s when this stuff first started coming forward that these things were almost prohibitively expensive. And so much of it had to do with how many tracks you wanted to do simultaneously. Most of the time you could record maybe one or two tracks at a time. If you wanted low eight tracks at a time, oh my gosh. I mean, you could spend thousands of dollars on a external interface to do that, to take it away from the computing power of your computer. Computing power of your computer. I just said that. That really sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? Well, nowadays, they're so fast, even a cell phone can do it. So a little box like this allows giving you an XLR or quarter-inch input. You plug it right into your computer with USB. No power supply needed. This thing is actually powered by the USB that your laptop puts out. Now, I prefer, but again, I know that this is opinion, I prefer the Apple brand of computers because guess what? They're not loaded down with a bunch of crap. You don't have a bunch of McAfee this or free sample of that. They just work, okay? But most Mac computers come loaded with a program called GarageBand, which is a very simple DAW or a multi-track interface. You literally plug this into your computer, you'll hear a little ding, and it'll say, oh, I've recognized this. Oh, how cool is that? Okay. You plug your microphone of choosing in or your guitar, and you go to your GarageBand software, select new track, hit record and play, and you'll see it, your audio popping up on the track. It is so simple. Now, at this point, I almost think, you know, you can go super complex. And I would love for people to chime in if they're into this. By the way, we got a few more comments, and we do appreciate it. Billy chimed in. He goes, man, I got to come back and watch this. Have a few things I need to handle. Hope you get into eight or more tracking at once. We need to look at my options one day, Brad. Yes, we do, Billy. Anytime you guys want to talk about options. And then we received a very touching compliment from my friend Matt, who said, you sounded like Scooby-Doo.
Shaggy? Scooby Snacks?
Okay, that's my best Scooby-Doo. You don't want to hear my worst, let me just tell you that. So that being said, when you get into the recording, computers have made things just incredibly both simple and complex. Isn't that the case? I mean, look at our social interactions with things like Facebook. I mean, goodness sakes, did you honestly think 15 years ago that we would have to be thinking about Facebook drama? I mean, so in one sense, it's really cool technology, but it somewhat can complicate things if you want it to. So when you get into the world of DAWs and different styles of recording software, there are so many to choose from. I can't even begin. Most interfaces that you buy will come packaged with free software. So really, software is one of those things where you can demo things, see what things are fit. Some of y'all are really good at like trying different softwares. Some of y'all are like me, you know, where you just want to find something that you like and just stick with it. Okay, not have to try a million different things. So just understand that software can get crazy. Additionally, now they have things like soft synths. So you don't even need a keyboard anymore. You can just use a controller and you've got synthesizers on your software. You even have what's called virtual instruments. Let's say that you want to sound like your amp is a 1959 narrow panel Fender Deluxe. They've got a sound for that. It can be very incredible, but also just daunting. Everything is available now because of software. But I'll tell you what, most of y'all may not want to jump into the deep end of the pool. It can be very expensive and very tiring to learn all this stuff. But if you've just got a good quality microphone, a good interface like this in GarageBand, and you like the sound of your amp, just play with it, you know, stick your mic in front of it and be like, hey, man, this is pretty cool. Now, this picture that has been pulled up here is kind of another thing I was going to talk about. So this interface that I'm showing here, it's just got two channel inputs. But some people are playing bands, but additionally, they want to go home with their equipment and use it to record themselves. So the comment we had earlier from Billy, he was talking about eight channels simultaneously. What Billy is doing, Billy's actually a very talented local drummer, and he wants to record all of his drums. So he wants to put a microphone on every one of his drums, cymbals, and so on. Play a beat or lick or whatever. And then, using his computer, have each one of those microphone channels track separated so he can bring the volume down on one, EQ another one, effectively craft it to make it sound the way he wants it to sound. Then take that recording and email it to somebody to use in a recording of their own. Well, a mixer like this is an easy way to do it. So Mackie and other companies, but you know, we like the Mackie products, has come out with a new model called the Onyx. And the Onyx is a regular pro audio mixer. You could take it out for your band, plug your thing in, you know, basically use it as a live sound mixer. But then at home, you can plug it in just like you would live, but then plug your USB into your laptop, then into your DAW or your digital audio workstation, and it track separates every channel that you plug in. So channel one, track one, channel two, track two, so on and so forth. How cool is that? You know, for a very affordable price, these are well less than $1,000. So, you know, with this, you have this mixer that's very easy to understand. Oh, this fader brings the volume up and down a channel one and so on. Well, guess what? Now those are going right into your recording software. Pretty neat, you know, for a really inexpensive price. I think this Onyx 16 sells for less than $1,000. Just to put in perspective, back when in the 1990s, there was a revolutionary piece of equipment made by Roland, which Roland makes just the best audio tech. They are always on the leading edge. They made a piece of gear called the VS-880. It was an 8-track digital recorder. You could record 2 tracks simultaneously, but 8 tracks total. It even, if for an extra $300, you could put a card in there that gave you some reverb and some effects. That piece of gear was $2,500. If you wanted the reverb, you spent another $300 for the internal effects card. Now, see, now you got $2,800 in this thing for 8 total tracks. If you wanted to get it to some sort of other format, you still needed a mixed down deck, meant like a tape deck, or you could buy the VS8F1 CD recorder, which was another $700, and it was just simply a what now we would call a CDR. So you'd be into this thing $3,500 for 8 total tracks, whereas if you go down to Walmart and buy a relatively affordable laptop, you can get this Mackie thing for $179. It has effects, it has, you know, you can record as many tracks as your computer will handle. So, I mean, there's no excuse for anybody to not getting to recording in one way or another. Now, I know some people might want to talk about, well, I mean, how do I set up a studio with microphones and stuff? Listen, now, I don't want to get into that subject simply because when you're talking about microphones or talking about miking techniques or room insulating or whatever, you're talking about a completely different subject. Because how is that any different than what mic should I use live or what amp should I use live? Again, what do you like the sound of? I mean, that's completely your opinion, and it has nothing to really do at all with the discussion of getting it into your recorder. But I did bring some different microphones here. You can see any mic that you can dream up. So, I mean, we've got, of course, the dynamic mic that I'm using right here, the MV7, which these are great. One below here is a Shure SM7. That's what Michael Jackson used on the Thriller album. And here's a Shure, what's called a condenser microphone called the KSM27. These are a large diaphragm condenser microphone. So these are good for recording vocals or anything that's very sensitive and so on. But whatever microphone you want to plug into an interface, that's fine. But that gets into the preference of what you want to hear. It has nothing to do with the actual recording aspect of it, okay? The nuts and bolts. Now, one thing that we get a lot of people who request, we have people who maybe are a singer-songwriter, and they're saying, man, I've just got these ideas, and I just want to quick get them down so that we can come back to them later. Brilliant, right? So again, back in the olden days, we used to have the micro cassette recorder. You know, you have these little bitty cassettes and slide it in and note to self, get on the treadmill more often, you know, or whatever. And they don't even make those anymore, I don't think. I don't know. Well, now you can get like this little product here. It's made by Shure. Again, Shure sponsors our show, by the way, and they make great stuff. And so we're naturally going to always want to show y'all good stuff, not junky stuff, counterfeit junk made in China and sold on Amazon, right? So I'm going to show you some really cool stuff. So the Shure makes this little microphone that's designed to plug right into your iPhone or iPad. It's called the MV88. And if you've ever watched any of our just quick impromptu videos on Mainstage Music Facebook page, we use the MV88. That's how we get better quality sound than most cell phone videos. But it's a microphone that plops right into the lightning port on your computer, and boom, you got a great mic. They also make a slightly bigger one that'll work with Android or iOS. So this is a great way to use it as a field recorder. So imagine that you're at the show, and hey, I'm gonna take pictures, and man, everybody's gonna be so jelly that we're down here at Shinedown, and this is the best song. But you guys have seen that kind of stuff. The picture looks great, but the audio is all crunchy and nasty, and it's like kind of throws water on the whole thing, doesn't it? Well, if you had a good quality microphone plugged into your phone, it would sound great. So, I mean, the point is it's a fairly inexpensive item that will really make your recordings pop. Additionally, you can use this microphone as a really high-quality field recorder. So imagine that you guys are, let's say you're thinking about a song idea. You pull your phone out, plug this microphone in, and record it, and it's perfect digital stereo sound. You can take that, email it to people, text it, whatever you want to do. It's just a great product for really inexpensive price. It sells for about $150, which is about what just a regular old microphone costs. It even comes in a nice little hard shell case. They're really, really a cool piece of gear. Additionally, there have been a lot of course, with this pandemic stuff going on, a lot of places, whether it's maybe a house of worship, maybe it's some sort of community center league or something like that where they may have meetings. Well, you have a lot of people who, you know, rightly so, are wanting to play it safe and not gather where you could spread and keep this stupid pandemic thing dragging on. So they want to get their message to shut-ins or people who just can't be there. So something like this allows you to record perfectly the sound that's going on and then stream it out to these people, or at least share it with them in a lot better way. So we get churches that go, we'd like to get into live streaming like what we're doing here. And I'm like, well, sure, that's about $12,000. You know, at that point, they're like, I thought it was going to be free, you know, or whatever. Here's the reality of it. To do the quality of a live stream where you have multiple cameras and so on, you're going to need two technicians, probably three computers, multiple cameras, tripods, stands. I mean, there's tons of things involved. It's on the low end a $10,000 endeavor. So if you want to do it kind of on the discount side of things, use a cell phone and a good quality microphone like this. Plop it in, and that way you can just stream right, you know, to the format off your phone. So this is a very cool little piece of gear that Shure makes. Now, I mean, in the end, when it comes to recording, you know, another thing that I absolutely love about the idea of recording is that we aren't going to be here forever, okay? So either A, you're only young once, you're only in this band once, you may only see this person once, or maybe you're trying to chronicle Maybe you've got an aged grandparent or relative or just someone in the community whose story needs to be told. If you have something that's worth hearing or worth knowing, it's worth it to record. And there's no excuse, either in knowledge or in a fiscal sense, to not have a decent recording setup. If you've got a computer, which you do, or you got a phone, which you do, you have the bulk of a recording studio in your pocket already. You just need to get those little bits, whether it's that interface or the little mic that plugs into your iPhone or whatever, to just finish off that studio. A little bit of learning. But, you know, I'll tell you, I was listening on the way here. Most of the music that I like was made before, let's say, 1970, okay? That stuff was great, too. But I love the older stuff. And the reason I loved it is back in those days, they had very minimal technology. I mean, yeah, you had the electric guitar and you had the microphone, which we stole from the Nazis, by the way. But generally speaking, we didn't have all the cool gadgets we had. But think of all the amazing music that we did get. Okay? So these guys were using minimal tech, maximum creative juices, right? So guys like Sam Phillips or any of these cats, they were thinking, what do we have? Let me try to use my mind to get the most out of it. So when we're talking about something like a cell phone microphone, just know that that piece of gear is far more advanced than what Santo and Johnny recorded Night Walk with or Sleepwalk with, okay? Iconic recording. Amazing quality, really, the whole warmth of it and everything. There's no excuse why you guys can't be making the same quality and kind of stuff now. Except that we're getting addicted to technology, and so then we want to blame everything else on why we're not creating. Sorry, not sorry. You don't have an excuse. So if you guys wanted, you know, more of this kind of stuff, we obviously have it at the shop, and we're always there to try to help you guys out. There are so many resources. It truly is a rabbit hole, okay? But one thing I'll tell people, when it comes to recording, I almost view it like a bell curve. Do you guys know what a bell curve is? So a bell curve, you have your X and your Y, you know, axis, and then the curve is, you know, kind of moving in time, all right? So I would say the recording bell curve kind of works like this. The X-axis is how much gear you have. So the higher it is, the more gear you have, the lower it is, nothing. And the Y is how long you've been doing this. What you find is that we always start at zero. And as you learn how to use stuff, you start buying more gear and buying more gear and buying more gear. And eventually you reach the top of this curve where, holy smokes, it probably takes you 20 minutes just to turn all your stuff on. Then you go, you know what, I could probably do without this and do without this and do without that. You'll never get back to the bottom unless you quit, but you'll find that there is some comfortable place right there where you have a great microphone, some sort of simple interface to record to, and of course, you've got all the ideas and experience and imagination. So the point is regardless of where you are in the recording bell curve, you know, we're here to help and we want to help you guys. And I'm so excited to hear the kind of cool recordings that y'all make or the history of your community or your family that you are able to chronicle by using maybe a little bit of advice. And just let me know, let me tell you, it's not that scary. And anyone in any age bracket can do it. I don't want to hear about that old dogs, and I'm an old dog, okay? And I'm still learning this stuff, and it's not hard anymore. So, but that being said, I appreciate you guys watching. I appreciate the comments and so on. And we've had a lot of solid viewers on here. I encourage you to share the video. If you're not on our YouTube channel, I encourage you to subscribe. If you have any show ideas or anything like that you would like to add, hey, text it to me. I'm pretty easy. But otherwise, I will see you guys next Tuesday. And same bat time, same back channel. And don't be a stranger, y'all. Appreciate it.
Atomic batteries to power. Turbines to speed.
out.